Good afternoon, Cloud Native community, and welcome back to Atlanta, Georgia here. We're steaming through day one of our 3 days of live coverage at KubeCon on theCUBE. My name's Savannah Peterson, bringing you all the most brilliant guests from the show floor with Rob Strechet. Rob, were you expecting it to be this cold this week?
I wasn't. It's cold Lanta. Like, legit is cold Lanta.
Actually freezing.
It was below freezing. 29 degrees this morning when I came over. I was like, this is crazy.
You're used to this in the Northeast.
I am
a Californian, Rob, and this is atrocious. Yes. But thankfully here to warm us up with a very exciting conversation is Anjali and Roman. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having us. Yeah.
This is going to be a great one. I want to start by talking about trust. We are in a very unique era when it comes to AI tooling everything, where really trust is at the core of everything that we're doing in terms of selecting partnerships. Anjali, I want to open it up to you. What does zero trust mean in the AI era?
It's a great question. Zero trust in general means that you trust no one first, you always verify, and then you base that verification on an identity, and then you trust the person. As you would trust anyone, you would, you know, users or like humans, you would also trust machines the same way. And with AI, we want to sort of bring in the same trust that we already have built into the system. You know, we want to make sure that the users, the machine, all the trust that we have brought in with the best practices around that. That translates to AI workloads also, AI agents also. Of course, there are nuances with AI agents, but then we want to extend that same trust fabric, the same tenets of trust, always verify, you know, and then trust, so, yeah.
So I mean, you guys were at SecurityCon yesterday, you've been out with the people, like, understanding. What are some of the major challenges that people are seeing with Kubernetes and with agentic AI in particular as they're going through? What are you hearing?
So some of the things that we are hearing from people is, you know, like we have onboarded our applications on Kubernetes. Now is AI a whole new thing that we want to now tackle? Well, we've, you know, and this is what I talked about in my keynote as well. We already have put in so much work in getting these technologies right. We don't have to rebuild everything. You know, there's a lot of reuse that we can do. We can use the same principles, zero trust principles, and then extend them to AI. So I'll say this, with AI there's a lot of fear involved, and that's what I, you know, got as a response. But my response to that is, just be curious. Try it out in a safe environment and then extend it.
Yeah. What are you hearing, Roman?
Yeah, that's all like great questions. I think the major challenges that we face with AI right now is the enormous speed with which we make these innovations happen. And as you mentioned, we can't stop the progress. We are not going back. Kubernetes is here and cloud native environments are here. We just need to make it all right. We just need to educate developers to cook AI, right?
And love that.
Yeah. Yeah, and this is major challenge as well. Besides that, we hear a lot of concerns as this hybrid cloud infrastructure rolled out across the companies, across different geos. We hear these so-called digital sovereignty concerns. Everybody wants to make sure that the technologies that they build and use are, they can control them. And this notion expands to AI as well. And that's why technologies like confidential computing, for example, comes to play. Confidential computing is all about securing data in use when you can protect your workloads while in use, so nobody, including the cloud providers or administrators, they can't access your data because it's encrypted. And that becomes critically important in the age of AI because now we share all this data across the globe between the companies, and also we share models, and of course we're going to make sure that nobody have access to this confidential information.
And you guys are even going further because we were talking a little bit earlier about post-quantum and things of that nature.
Oh yeah, very exciting.
Yeah, I mean, but AI really breaks some boundaries, right? Because there's a lot of data in these models. There's a lot of data people want to put in these models. How do you see, you know, trusted AI really evolving? And start with you.
Yeah, you mentioned data, and that's a really great point, because when we look at how AI systems work, it's really fast. Developers just consume these models straight away from Hugging Face with their one command, and nobody really knows what's inside, and there is a possibility to include their malicious codes there, and there are tons of examples, and I think the recent example was just 1 month ago, a few months ago, that they legitimately looking, but in fact malicious cloud code repo included some malware that consumed straight away by developers in the cloud, and then they steal the credentials, the anthropic credentials of the developer's machine, and exposes some of the critical data out of the infrastructure. So that's the problem. Now, how to approach this problem? The data is very important, because we often don't know how these models were trained and how this data was collected, and again, this is a possibility to include something malicious to poison this data. That's why data provenance concept comes to picture. That means making sure that we understand how data was collected upon which the models are trained, and we can actually put, so I put it that way, like a nutrition table, right? What's the purpose of this data? What's the geo? What's the license, and et cetera, so that it could be then signed and verified down the chain as developers consume this data, as we roll out these AI systems, and as users interact with these systems.
So you're making sure that it's safe and easy to use all the way through the line.
Exactly.
Which is really important, because that's a wildly huge risk. You think about everybody vibe coding or doing things right now, and yes. You don't know what you just put into all of your data or on your machine or in your cloud. I mean, it's actually kind of spooky to think about. let's talk a little bit about, well, so this is kind of fun. We were talking, Rob and I, just a second ago, open source is really having a moment. Like, I feel like the whole industry, and even like, I feel like my mom knows what open source is right now. Hi, Mom, by the way. but we're kind of having a moment. And I think it's really interesting, because we've all been fans of building in public and transparency and, yes. and the education of the community within that. How is that going to help influence the overall industry as we move into the era of regulation, with some of the AI regulation acts going on in Europe and around the world? Anjali, I'll start with you.
You mentioned regulations for AI and how this is impacting. From my perspective, I work a lot with open source projects, and what we are seeing is, you know, how you mentioned data as well, right? Like, how do we make sure that the data remains in the regions that you're looking for, and then you build policies around it, and then you build frameworks around it, and then how does the infrastructure react to that, right? Build, deploy, run, and making sure that you have the right governance model throughout that process is how we would approach it, and I'm seeing more and more community people coming together to build that.
Oh, that's refreshing. Well, I'm not surprised.
Yeah. And what are you seeing?
Yeah, I think you pointed out, right, this is an open source moment, and not even our relatives and grandparents know about open source, but also policymakers around the world, they notice that open source is such a thing, and they finally understood. They finally understood that open source is not that something that is pure for hobbyists. Linux runs the world, right? And that was the huge eye opener for some of the regulators. That's why open source industry right now is facing some of the tensions, because with the introduction things like the European Union Cyber Resilience Act, which at first glance applies to manufacturers, to vendors of the software and hardware, but then it also introduced the notion of so-called open source software steward, that means to be in between vendors and users. By stewards, we can understand the foundations like Linux Foundation, for example, or some major companies like Red Hat who supports this open source project. And now, with this mandatory requirement for manufacturers and for stewards, it becomes clear that open source and security of open source, and in particular supply chain, is such a big deal, and now it's no longer an option or a good standard that you need to follow. Now it's mandatory. And now is a great moment for all of us in the ecosystem actually to stand together and work together and solve this problem. And we at Red Hat see positive things in the regulations like EU Cyber Resilience Act, because finally this is a major push to get us all by the one table and speak to each other and help open source projects to eventually improve their security posture.
Yeah, I was going to say, and you kind of hit on this a little bit, and I want to kind of tie the parallels back to AI. To me, you know, 3 years ago in Amsterdam, we were talking about SBOMs, you know, all the time.
We really were. I'm glad you just brought that back. Wow.
Legit.
That was the theme.
The theme.
That was totally the theme.
It was also very sunny there.
Yes.
And not cold. But anyway, unlike Atlanta. But so when we pull back to SBOMs, we've learned a lot about SBOMs. SBOMs are always a great idea. I've had to do it with software projects that I've done. What lessons have we learned there, and how do they apply to AI? And we'll kick it off with you.
Yeah, sure. You're right, that bombs are really important, and again, now is the right moment when pretty much everybody understands that we need to produce SBOMs, we need to do something with that, and it's also a part of the standards and regulations. Now everybody must do SBOMs. In the age of AI, I think that, again, contributes to the notion of trust. As much information we have about the system itself and all of the dependencies that are in software, as better we can be prepared to the potential attacks or kind of malicious behaviors or vulnerabilities that can be in our systems. Now I think the notion of SBOMs is expanded to AI bombs, when you can collect all of this information about AI system and the model and some of the other dependencies in the standardized machine-readable format, so that all the developers, again, can then verify that everything is legitimate there.
And what we've seen is also, you know, the AI bomb system itself is expanding. It started off with models. Now there are MCP servers, there are MCP clients, agents. So, you know, this is a very evolving space. And standards are also sort of confirming, and we are, you know, excited to have open source community contribute in this.
Yeah, I mean, I look at it and go, it's just such an evolving landscape that really, when you look at it, some of the lessons that we've learned along the way, like building security in, designing security in from the beginning has
secure
to
by
be
design,
there.
Maybe. Yeah. Yeah.
Where do you see this going as we go into, because AI complicates things. Like you said, even MCP, and there was like 6 months ago, everybody's like, you get an MCP server, you get an MCP server, and it wasn't secure, and it wasn't a secure protocol at the time. Now things are being done around that.
That's a great point, Rob.
How do you see this secure by design going forward?
And that's, you know, in fact, we did a tutorial just before this on how to build in trust into this framework, how to build the trust fabric. Really, as you said, you know, everyone is using MCP, and now it's so getting trust right from the start is very important. Using your tools like OAuth, KeyCloak, OIDC, and SPIFFE SPIRE, by the way, for workload identity. You know, we need to start reusing those concepts into this framework and building it with that. We also talked a little bit about MCP Gateway that will help with, you know, authentication, authorization, and controls. The controls are really important to build in from the start.
That's what I'm saying. They're imperative. I mean, I don't think things will get off the ground if you lose that trust, especially in this stage with the amount of risk velocity and everything else going on in our AI world, no matter if it's agentic or not. I have one final question for you fabulous individuals. when we have the joy of reconnecting at KubeCon 2026 in Salt Lake City next winter, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't yet say today? Roman, I'll start with you on this one since I've put Anjali in the hot seat twice.
I think as I look into the future, I would really like to see the more standards come to play about AI so that we don't invent the new protocol each day, because it really affects security eventually. And that's why it's very important that right now we are collectively, as an open source community, just working within the Linux Foundation, OpenSSF, CNCF, and other communities like Oasis Open or OWASP to standardize some of these things. So that next year we can say, okay, for this particular agentic workflows or protocols, we have those standards, and probably the majority of vendors already implement this secure by design standard, so that we minimize the attack surface and we all innovate faster and secure.
And I really want to see more people use AI. I want to see them use AI. You cannot make progress until you try it, but try it in a safe environment. Try it where you can have these controls and you have control over the system, and we know what the output is going to be like, and it should make you want to make sure it doesn't harm anything. So I want, in 2026 when we meet, I would like to see more people use it and take it to production as well.
Love that. Well, we want to see both of those things. Anjali and Roman, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, and thank
you. That was all the fun.
I know, good. Yes, yeah. Tell all your friends, we love hearing that.
Yes.
We did not pay him to say that, for the record. We are having as much fun as it appears on camera here in frigid Atlanta, Georgia, at KubeCon CloudNativeCon. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.